tells us, I am the resurrection, and I am life, says the Lord. Whoever has faith in me shall have life, even though they die. And everyone who has life and has committed himself to me in faith shall live eternally. Would you please rise if you're able as we sing our gathering hymn, How Great Thou Art.
Thank you.
person like Jim to live with, to worship with, and to just be with. So our first reading for this afternoon is taken from the book of Ecclesiastes, the third chapter. And this is probably a few verses that you've heard before. The Ecclesiastes was written by King Solomon. And we believe that King Solomon wrote these words towards the end of his life. If you know anything about King Solomon, he had quite the life. He had riches, he even had his own zoo, he was the king, he had everything. And at the end of his life, he began to realize that life is about cycles. And in these words, he talks about there being a time for everything. So hear these words from God's Word. Our reading from Ecclesiastes, the third chapter. There is a time for everything, and a season for every activity under the heavens. A time to be born, and a time to die. A time to plant, and a time to uproot. A time to kill, and a time to heal. A time to tear down, and a time to build. A time to weep, and a time to laugh, a time to mourn, and a time to dance, a time to scatter stones, and a time to gather them, a time to embrace, and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to search, and a time to give up, a time to keep, and a time to throw away, a time to tear, and a time to mend, a time to be silent, and a time to speak, a time to love, and a time to hate, a time for war, and a time for peace. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. Our psalm I'd like us to read responsibly this afternoon is one we all know and we love. It's Psalm 23, as God's word reminds us that God, and more specifically Jesus Christ, will tell us in John's gospel that he is the Good Shepherd. So let us read Psalm 23 responsively, with you please reading the bolded verses. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures.
He leads me beside the still waters.
He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Grace and peace to you from God the Father, and from our Lord, and from our Savior Jesus, who is the Christ. Amen. I love this image that Jesus gives us of vines and branches, because we're in the middle of summer, and if you drive around the countryside, you'll see those vines growing, but you'll also see some areas that, you know, the vines are beginning to shrivel up, and we're getting a late summer, late July, and you can really see the type of image that Jesus is trying to teach us. He uses this picture. Jesus is good at this. He often uses everyday things to teach us more about who he is and more about who God is, more about what heaven is like. I just picture if Jesus were alive today and he was living here in Nebraska, he'd probably talk a lot about tractors and combines and soybeans and corn and all those other things that we love and experience as a part of our daily lives. But when Jesus lived 2,000 years ago, he tried to think about those things that everybody knew about, the common things. And he would take the simple common things and he would start teaching us lessons. He tells us that he is the vine and we are the branches. That the vine and the branch has to work together, because that vine cannot grow without a good, sturdy branch. And a branch doesn't have the same purpose if it's not working alongside the vine. Jim was a follower of Christ. He strove to follow in Jesus' words. Today is a day of sorrow because we have to say goodbye. We have to say goodbye to a husband. And Alice, I know he loves you. Alice and Jim were married 45 years. 45 years. The love and everything that Jim and Alice experienced in life. They committed their lives together for 45 years, and Charles, their son, and then the family, and all the memories that they shared. If you haven't had a chance to take a look at the pictures on the back table, you just get the snapshot of the love that this family enjoyed together. It's hard to say goodbye. It's hard to say goodbye to a friend. It's hard to say goodbye to a father. It's hard to say goodbye to a person like Jim. But today is also that day of joy. It's a day of joy because Jesus makes us promises. Jesus promises us that this life, no matter how short it may be, and even 75 years in the terms of thinking about how long all of eternity is, 75 years is but the blink of an eye. Jesus and God made Jim a promise, just like God makes you a promise, that this life is not its. And elsewhere in John's gospel, Jesus promises us that when we get ready to take our last breath, that Jesus himself will take us by the hand. And I know as Jim took that last breath, he reached out to him to lead him to his eternal home. I'm so very glad to see our honor guard here today. Jim spent 20 years, I believe, in the military. 20 years, although he first started in the Navy, and then he went to the Army. And so I know I'm not military, but I know there can be some tension between Army and Navy. Am I right? And I don't know who Jim rooted for in the annual Army-Navy game. I bet that was kind of hard to pick a side. But Jim was... he was patriotic. He stepped up. He answered that call. He was brave, incredibly brave, serving two tours in Vietnam. You stop and you think about that. Going to the other side of the world, a place that we Americans had never really even heard about or knew anything about, and then Jim stepped up both times to defend his country, to defend what he knew to be right and true in this world. He was a man of great honor and dignity, serving our nation for 20 years. I understand that he and Alice met when they were both in the Army. And if you haven't heard this story, it's a great story. Alice tells it wonderful. So if you haven't heard this story, have Alice tell you this story. Give her a phone call or something like that. But she talks about setting up this date, this blind date. Am I right, Alice? This blind date that Alice had set up herself. She saw Jim probably looking all snazzy in his Army uniform. And Alice knew this was something that she had to act upon. And so the blind date was set up. It was successful. And the rest is history. 45 years. And it makes you stop and wonder. You know, what if they would have never met? Or what if Alice didn't have the courage to set up that blind date? Or what if Jim would not have switched from the Navy to the Army, which is where they met? So maybe we'll stick up for the Army today, at least for today. I don't know. But I believe that God had a hand in that. You can't help but to look at that and think that there's any other way to see this. That God directed their lives together. And the blessings of Jim's life, and the blessing of his and Alice's marriage. Ecclesiastes, the first passage that I read for today, talks about a time for everything. And King Solomon lived that life, but he lived before Jesus Christ came into this world. And so King Solomon did not fully understand what God had in mind. He knew God, he walked with God, he worshiped God, but King Solomon lived well before Jesus Christ came into this world. And Jim lived this life too, and Jim experienced this life. He coached baseball, he served our nation, he worshiped God, he went on vacations, fishing, and just being with his family. And I got a feeling if King Solomon were to add one last verse to this, he would talk about Jesus Christ. There's a time to live, there's a time to love, there's a time to serve your country, and there's a time to die. But this morning, or this afternoon, let's remind ourselves that Jesus has the final answer. That Jesus tells us that death is not the end. That Jim walked with Jesus. That Jim followed Jesus. And because of that, Jesus made promises to Jim. I believe that Jim is with Jesus right now. That Jim is in God's loving, eternal hands. And Jim was a lover of pets. And I've been asked before, Pastor, are there pets in heaven? And I don't know. I mean, the Bible doesn't talk about this, but I have to believe that Jesus and God wants heaven to be a place that not only we enjoy, but words can't even begin to describe. As Alice said earlier, I believe that Jim is with Sunny, their toy poodle, and Angel. And those two, right? These dogs that Jim loved, and Jim was a pet lover. And so today, let us remember Jim. Let us be together in our sorrow, but let us have some comfort, and let us rejoice that Jim followed Jesus, and because of that, Jesus welcomed him home. Amen?
Amen.
Would you please rise, if you're able, as we confess the Christian faith that we hold in common, using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom, and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, commend Jim to the mercy of God, our Maker and our Redeemer. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, James Jacob. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. Let us go forth in hope and in peace. In the name of Christ.